afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Spokane Valley Fire Department's Medic Monday. I'm going to be your host, R.W. Pegau is my name. I'm a paramedic here at the fire department. Today's first edition, first topic, we're going to talk about dehydration. Let's go through the basics and just kind of learn how to best protect ourselves, what we're kind of looking for, and what we can do with or without an entire semblance of medical gear to try to protect ourselves. So let's jump in. First thing first, what is dehydration? Dehydration quite simply could be described as you've outputted more fluid than you brought in. Simple as that. I put out more than I could bring in. Yeah, well, no duh. But the problem is dehydration can affect you rather quickly and can take a really kind of prolonged time to really bring your body back to where it needs to be. So it's one of those where not only knowing what dehydration is important, but it's important to know early enough of what you're gonna do about it to try to get your body back in the game so you can stay out and enjoy this beautiful weather and not succumb to a heat-related issue. Okay, who do you think is the most vulnerable in dealing with dehydration issues? If you guessed young kids or very old people, bam, you just got your first points of the day. By far, in a way, those are the two demographics that have the most problem with regulating their own metabolic industry, as well as specifically their water intake and water output. There's some very specific things we want to look for that are kind of differentiating between a really young person, young child with dehydration issues, and a kind of an older adult. So I recognize that some of you may have kids on your own, and probably a larger portion of you have kids that you might come in contact with that you're going to have to take care of. So those are going to be who we're going to jump at first. How do we try to identify that the young kids that we're around, that it might be ours or under our charge, are not getting dehydrated? What are some of the signs and symptoms that we can look for that can help us determine? Well, I got two red flags I really want you to pay attention to right away, and that's vomiting and diarrhea with little kids. Those are the two main ways that they're going to eject the most volume of fluid from their body, and it's going to be the hardest to try to get it back. So if you got a little one, brother, sister, or a child of your own that's real young, and they're having bad diarrhea and bad vomiting, that's a big issue. You need to get on it right away with trying to get some fluids, and it might include getting medical help, and that is okay. With older adults, the issue is less on just vomiting, just diarrhea. Obviously, that would affect all of us without question, right? But now you have, with the older adults, you have the issue of, well, what medications is that person on? What am I on? And what effect does that have both on my metabolism and my ability to regulate getting good water and getting something out of the water that I'm taking, as well as what is the effect that medication is having? Now, I think a lot of us have heard this, hey, don't take this medication without drinking a whole lot of water. Well, there's a purpose behind that. I mean, your kidneys are dramatically affected if your water level is low. And so some of these medications, because they work at that level cellularly anyway, you really gotta have water in. It's almost like a double whammy. If you're older and you take meds and you're getting dehydrated, odds are you're really putting yourself in a world of hurt. All right, we can reverse mild to even moderate level dehydration with a simple arsenal of tools. And we're going to go through a little list. Quick shout out to my favorite roasters, West Plains Roasters out in Cheney. So if you have the option of, to hydrate yourself, a cup of coffee, a little 8 ounce of water or 16 or whatever of Gatorade, what would you choose? And I bet you most of us would think we're choosing right away with pointing out water. Okay. And I don't think you're wrong for that, but I want to throw something at you. When you're dehydrated, not only have you lost fluid balance, just outright fluid, but you've also lost this thing called electrolytes. Now, I in no way am prepared to speak on what electrolytes do at a cellular level, so I'm going to stay in my lane and quickly say that electrolytes simply help your body send signals through the muscles from one cell to the next. They're a conduit, they're a transmitter. So if your electrolytes are imbalanced, you're gonna get messed up signals. And at its worst, that can result in even like seizures and stuff like that. But that's at its kind of worst case. At its more simple case is your onset of what we're gonna talk about in another topic, which is our three forms of heat emergencies. And it would start off with heat cramps. That's one of the first things you'd probably see once you start getting electrolyte imbalance. But my point of telling you about electrolytes and them being this little carrier thing that helps your signals, electrical signals, get from one cell to the other is to say that this big old pile of sugar water right here, oddly enough, has a lot of electrolytes in it, and you want it. So if you are really feeling the heat and you're feeling dehydrated, yes, we want you to drink the water, but you somehow, you got to get a little bit of this up in you as well. The best kind of recommendation that that we're pushing out there is a 50-50 would be great. So split that Gatorade between a couple of people, dump out half into another glass, and then a full 50%, the same volume of water into both of those. So essentially you've got a watered down 50-50 blend of Gatorade to water. That's an absolutely fantastic method for you to get the electrolytes back in your system without necessarily flooding yourself with just sugar water. Soda is your number one enemy, as much as I hate to say it. If you're living off Mountain Dew and Red Bull, you are not helping yourself. Okay, let's go over some symptoms. I talked about some of the extreme symptoms with a child, which would be what? Vomiting and diarrhea. But let's look at some more moderate or modest symptoms so we know what we're looking for ahead of time. Hey, you got that young child that is really dry mouth, complaining of thirst, having a hard time maybe even making that smacking sound, the really dry mouth, dry tongue, that's an issue. No tears when crying. Holy cow, kids are gonna be crying all the time. This should be something that all of us could pick up on right away. Is it dry crying or is it wet crying? No wet diapers. All right, well, I don't know what stage you're at the point, if you're having to be the one changing the diapers or not, but I think a lot of us can sense and kind of smell whatever when a child's got a wet diaper. If it's been more than 2 or 3 hours, no way. That kid needs to have a wet diaper. They need to have used the bathroom. If it's been longer than that, your child is dehydrated and we need to work on it. Sunken eyes, sunken cheeks, and there's this really neat kind of way of determining if you've got dehydration in a really small child that's called a sunken fontanelle. Now, for those of you that don't know, the fontanelle is a center spot on the top of the skull where the skull hasn't actually formed together yet. It's a small little opening that's made so that the bone has a chance to form as the skull forms. Well, because there's no bone over this small opening, piece of skin over the skull that's called the fontanelle, if it's sunken in, you know your child's really dehydrated. That's a real telltale sign. And kind of conversely, if it's got some level of inflammation or bulge to it, that's a sign of not necessarily of dehydration, but of intracranial pressure, which is also a bad thing. But that's one of the things that you as a person can look for in your own child. Is their fontanelle flat and flush with the top of their skull, or does it seem sunken in? Okay, let's move on to some adults. What do we think our main signs and symptoms would be that we're looking for on an adult? Again, the vomiting, the diarrhea, that'd be huge. But a lot of us get that to some degree as adults. And as long as it remedies itself within a 24-hour period, it's not really that critical. So as adults, what do we have? Extreme thirst. Jeez. Well, I hate to be the first one to tell it to you, but if extreme thirst is what you're looking for to determine if you're thirsty or not, or if your body is dehydrated, you're way behind. And I mean, sincerely, you're 1 to 2 hours probably, in my estimation, behind the eight ball on trying to get your body actually rehydrated. So, less frequent urination, sure, that's a sign. Especially when a tot out like this, it's easy to go hours between urinating. But the reality is, you should probably be peeing one time an hour anyway, and your pee should have a certain color. We're gonna get to this topic here in a minute when we start talking pee. All right, if you have dark colored urine, you know right away something is wrong, and you need to do whatever you can to try to get that body back in balance. Start hitting your water, 50-50% with your electrolytes if you need, but water's your winner at that point. Okay, if you're having any of these three, you're in trouble and dehydration has really started to affect you. If you're having dizziness, fatigue, confusion, concentration issues, anything like that, you're at the point where just drinking some water might not be enough and you might consider trying to get your family to help you out. You need to be in the shade or indoors, in some AC, with some water and cooling yourself off. All right, I feel like we went through a really good amount of, there's a risk, right? The really young and the really old, all of us can be affected by dehydration, but those two demographics, we wanna be really concerned with finding if we're dehydrated as early as possible so we can do something with it. Now, truth be told, and I would imagine this primarily applies to the older demographics. If you have a complicated medical history to include, really if you have anything to do with your kidneys, you need to take hydration even more serious than just a regular person. You have a legitimate impediment into your own health, and staying super hydrated is probably one of the best things you can do to make sure that those organs are really working for you. Let's talk about a couple of complications. What if you're in a type of job where you're stuck outside? You're a laborer, you're in the military, you're an athlete that's job is now outside. I mean, what if you're simply at home like the rest of us trying to deal with this whole COVID-19 business and 2020, the year of trying to write this one off, and you're stuck at home and we're just trying to do stuff, right? A lot of us are stuck at home. We're trying to get things done, trying to be productive, and we're outside maybe even a little bit more than we would have been normally when you know, everybody was at their job. I think this is something that all of us can relate to, that the heat issues is gonna affect all of us. It's only July. And we all know out here in the Pacific Northwest, July doesn't hold anything to what August and September can be. So if you think it's bad now, it's going to be worse. There's your positive message for the day. All right, let's look at the image on the screen. Is this you? These are warning signs that your body is lacking in water. Really like this one. I thought this represented how a lot of us have felt at times. Let's look at some of these signs, because some of these you can see ahead of time, and they're great indicators that that somebody's getting dehydrated. If you are constipated and find that you have to push excessively to try to empty your bowels, that is a great indicator that you are dehydrated. That can be obviously affected for some of us who are on medications, and in the older demographic, a little bit of constipation is semi-normal, but this is a great indicator that something is not right and we need to do something about it. Joint and muscle pain. Geez, if you have gotten to the point where your joints and muscles hurt, your body is dehydrated and we need to do something about it. Lightheadedness and headaches, that's a serious sign. Same with the accelerated heartbeat. If you have any of those, your condition has moved beyond just mild dehydration, and I would be concerned. I'd want to get checked out. Fatigue and lethargy, those are very similar type concepts for those that aren't familiar with those two words. And it basically means you just don't have any energy. You don't have any of the motto, you don't want to do anything, and you're just kind of stuck doing nothing. And a kind of obscure one that is, I guess, harder for a lot of us to recognize, because so many of us probably drink coffee and have stuff that sours your breath anyway, but bad breath and a really dry mouth can also be a great indicator that your body is now starting to be dehydrated. One more time, what is our solution at home? What can we actually do to try to stop dehydration and start getting hydrated? Number one fix. Grab yourself some water, mix it up 50-50 with that Powerade, Gatorade, All Sport, something like that. Get your electrolytes and get that water. Start early, start often, stay hydrated.